Welcome to Hail Varsity Radio, the voice of Husker Nation. Insight, opinion, expertise, with the biggest and best names talking Nebraska across the state. Join the show on Twitter at Hail Varsity and at Schmidt underscore radio. Call in at 402-466-ESPN or 1-800-825-5865. Here's Chris Schmidt.
Great to have you in Hail Varsity Radio Road Show Friday. We're out here at Wilderness Ridge, happy hour with Hail Varsity. It's just an amazing day. Not only is football back tomorrow, Nebraska at Northwestern, but it is November 6th. It is 77 degrees, and our feet are, well, not they're not kicked up, but man, it is just phenomenal weather. We're out here at Wilderness Ridge here in Lincoln, out on the deck. You are invited out. I see plenty of appetizers. I see the wine is flowing. There's lots of red here on the deck. Blackshirt Husker NFLer Jay Moore is on site. He hung the clubs up just a little bit ago, and he is here, our dear friend and insider Mike Schuchart. Shuey is also at the table, and we invite you out. Numbers to get in, 466-3776, 466-3776, 800-825-5865. Can find us on Twitter at Schmidt underscore radio, at Mike Schuchart, and at jmoore44. Email Chris at HaleVarsity.com. Elijah Herbal is staring at a picture of the sun back in studio. Bless his heart. Derek Peterson, Dr. Petey's coming up from Hail Varsity in 20 minutes. The Pride of Fairbury, Bill Doleman, will no doubt go off on the color purple in about 1 hour. And how it shouldn't be part of uniforms. And we will hear from Clauseborne, a massive roundtable with the Friday forecast coming up. Guys, it's awesome to see you. It's fantastic to be here at Wilderness Ridge for happy hour with Hail Varsity. Thank you both for stopping in and hanging out. And how good does it feel to have football a lot better than 10 other games that were scheduled tomorrow that are now postponed. But wow, what a day to be out on the deck. Enjoy the weather. And what a ball game, what an opportunity tomorrow for Nebraska.
It is. I mean, and we're, the equipment set up I saw in the locker room, so I think there's going to be football tomorrow.
There you is. Know, I'm still I love the Nebraska equipment tweeting that
right,
out.
Right, like, okay, it's I think it's going to happen. You know, I don't foresee
the old,
any
– The old dumb and dumber gift.
Right, right, correct. So you're saying there's a chance.
Chance.
You're right.
That was one great. In a thousand?
Right. Weather's
a million.
Right. Weather is weather's great here. You can't complain. I mean, what we had here, we're stealing some days. But yeah, you get football get at Northwestern. You know, it would make it better is, you know, having about 40,000 Nebraska fans there.
And there would have been
100% there would have been. But it's an opportunity to get better. It's an opportunity to get a win and learn how to win some football games, get some confidence for this football program going forward, and an opportunity to just get better. And that's all you can ask for right now. And you're playing a hell of a football team in a 2-0 Northwestern.
You've said it this week on Big Red Wrap-Up. You said it this morning with us on KFOR. But it is about confidence. You get confidence through doing. You get confidence through success. Shuey, you work with so many folks on their golf game, and it's repetition. It's practice, and then it's translation to winning a few bucks with that 2-foot putt, right?
With That's your, exactly with your, right.
Who's with putting your... 2-footers? Come on, those are gimmies.
Me.
Those are gimmies.
Exactly.
Depends the group you play with.
Some tight wads.
So the point I'm saying here is this: it's about the confidence side of things, and you know, there's a ton of storylines to get into with this, because Nebraska's been aching and itching, and they're really salty. They want to go play football, and that was taken away from them last Saturday. How difficult is it for Nebraska, for lack of a better term, to just, okay, you saw some good things against Ohio State. There's a lot you need to fix. They're elite, by the way. But you have that impromptu week off. How, even through practice, how difficult is it going to be for Nebraska to just kind of go flip the switch and go do their thing for their abbreviated game, too? Do you worry about a little rust tomorrow? And it's such a screwy season. So I don't know. I want your perspective just because you've lived it.
Yeah, a little concerning, you know. I mean, it's just concerning you're without two of your starting secondary for the first half.
Mm-hmm.
I think that rule needs, obviously, that should have been, there should have been an addendum to that, where if you've, you've got a
that
game
would require
canceled.
Communication from the Big Ten and foresight and forethought.
Right, yeah, and that's apparently...
it's kind of like the two-foot putt.
Right, right. It's apparently doesn't happen. I mean... it's comical, but that's just what we've come to expect. So
that's the neighborhood
right,
we're in,
right,
man.
A little bit, yeah. You know, it's. I mean, if you want to relate this to golf, it's like, okay, I've hit a ton of balls in the range. I'm beating balls in the range. I'm getting good at being a good range player. But guess what? Doesn't count.
I can hit the guy on the golf
right,
ball
right.
picker upper guy.
Yeah, I'm
that's
pretty
right.
good at hitting a 100-yard shot, 150-yard shot. You know, to you know, and having no circumstances when it, and all of a sudden you get out there and it matters and you see water and hazards and OB stakes and you're like, ooh, you know, now it's someone
linebackers
different.
Linebackers
you know.
And left tackles
right.
and quarterbacks.
And you got to execute when it matters. You know, you drop a pass, I'll get the next one. Well, you know what, you fumble, that's okay, I'll hang on. Well, no, now it matters.
Yeah.
Now it matters. And, you know, you can hope to recover from some of those, but Nebraska's just not good enough to recover from making too many bonehead mistakes, you know, and that's what's hurt them for
years.
Decade, you know, last decade or so, is shooting themselves in the foot. And I mean, they're walking around with no feet. I mean, that's just this pro, you know,
no more toes.
Right. So, you know, it's a little concerning. It is, but you know, I'd be a little more concerned if we were playing, I don't know, you know, Michigan or, you know, or
higher talent level,
but, To flip it, though, I mean, Northwestern, that's just – but they – Northwestern does not make mistakes. If they do, it's rare. They rarely have – they're one of the least penalized football teams in all of the nation and into the Big Ten. They rarely turn it over. They get a lot of turnovers. I mean, they got 7 turnovers so mm-hmm. far through 2 games. And they just – they know who they are. I mean, they're down 17-0 early to Iowa, and they just – they stay on pace.
Yep.
They don't try to get outside themselves. They don't try to chase anything. They stay patient and say, hey, you know, there's a lot of football to – game left and we can go and win this thing. So a little concerning, but you know, it is what I mean. Crazier things have happened. I mean, who would have, you know, I mean, Michigan State goes and beats Michigan last week. I mean, that's
anything can happen on a
right.
on a given
and
Saturday.
This is they're mm-hmm. two evenly matched teams. They are. I mean, honestly, if you want to match up recruiting rankings, Nebraska's way
blows
higher
them out of the water.
But that doesn't matter. You know, I mean, that just doesn't matter. Fitzgerald gets his teams to play well and play physical and play smart. Nebraska has to do the same to match up with them.
You know, flipping that switch, Shuey, and I'm feeling good. I'm super optimistic about tomorrow. I think Nebraska is going to channel disappointment and extra time and practice. They're going to do all of that and do it the right way. And I think they're a more talented football team. They still got to go do it. It's not a magic button or wand where all of a sudden you stop opening fire on your own feet and toes like we're talking about with Nebraska's mistakes. But I think the guys last time in Columbus obviously had a really good scheme going, great play call and game plan and execution with Nebraska the first half of Ohio State, and then they saw it unravel the final 4 minutes and then that third quarter. And the thing that sticks out to me, and I think the kids know this, and it's kind of up to them, where look how well the first half went against number 2 in the country. You hold them to 3, you're down 17-14, you're tied, quite honestly, with 4 minutes left to go. Every time you didn't screw up on your own, you drove the field, you got some big plays, you scored, you were tied, you were even with them, and these guys are all world talents. And then you see the second half where Nebraska drove it 3 times and ended up with 3 points. They had penalties in the second half, and then they had the 2 monster fumbles in the second half to keep within striking distance. Eventually, you can only be told so many times that these things will kill you. You felt it as a team, as a group of guys, against Ohio State, and then you got drilled 52-17, and then the national media got in line to swing away at you again. So there's a lot of that swirling around, and then last week happens, you get made fun of again. I think Nebraska's ready to take it out on somebody, and I think they can concentrate and be better as a group, as a unit, when it comes to penalties, when it comes to mistakes, and when it comes to ball security. I think now is the time they do take that step forward and actually take care of themselves, clean themselves up. They've seen it enough. And I liked what Adrian said earlier in the week as well. I mean, he addressed it about, you know, I've had problems with turnovers and fumbles, and the number's huge. I mean, it's 21 or 22 fumbles in his career, and that just can't happen. Do you automatically stop being that player, or does it slow you down from making plays, and you keep that no fear of failure mantra? I think they put it together for the first time and do show some consistency, and I think the extra time they've had to work and practice, although they're bored with it, they put it to good use. Maybe I'm too optimistic, Shuey, but I think this is the game that maybe you start, and if I'm listening to Scott Frost, and I believe him, about turning the corner. And I think you've got an opponent that you're as good or better than, you're more talented than. Some of your young pups, they'll need to step up, but your younger guys have played well. I think they can go do it tomorrow and probably do it if things break right and they do stay clean. Do it convincingly so it's not a 7 Jack Daniels Saturday hanging on in the fourth quarter against Northwestern.
Well, that's the key. I mean, they have to be consistent in what they do. I mean, that's what's killed them all year. It's like they get some momentum, they get feeling decent about themselves, and then all of a sudden they turn it over. Penalty. I mean, they can't keep some consistency and momentum going. You know, when they get a few drives, they look awesome at times when they do that. But they have such a propensity of just making a mistake at the wrong time.
Is that a mental thing, or is it just lack of concentration?
I think it's a little mental thing, actually. You know, because sometimes as you try,
when is something bad going to happen?
I call it my bomb theory.
Okay, let me hear this bomb theory, Shuey.
You're holding this bomb in your hand. You just don't know when it's going off, but you know it's going
You've
off.
Got it with you,
so you can drive it right down the middle of the fairway, perfect five holes in a row. But you know you're going to hit a snap hook out of bounds sooner or later. You just don't know when it's coming.
Yeah, Nebraska has a case of the PBFUs, the post birdie F-ups.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, they've made a good play. Then
good catch, Bird.
Right. You know, they have a good streak. You know, they get off to a good drive, and then they get some good things going, and then boom. You know, they shoot themselves in the foot. They can't get out of their own way. And sometimes I think it's a lack. Like, this team tries to do too much sometimes, in my opinion. I think Adrian tries to do – I think that's not a negative, but he tries to do – like, when he fumbles that ball against Ohio State, like, cut it up. Cut it up. He probably gets close to the first down, but he tries
you
to
have
bounce
the
it.
First.
Yeah, he tries to bounce it. He has a knack for trying to bounce it. I don't know if that's a good habit or a bad habit. He's not the fastest guy. He's not.
I don't think it's I'm afraid of contact thing. It's I want to get five more yards.
Yeah,
thing.
But sometimes you got to eat it. Like, you know, it's like
learn your battles.
Learn to throw the ball away as a QB. Yeah. Don't force it. Sometimes, you know, a second and 10 is better than back on the bench after you threw a pick.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's just learning to, you know, pick and choose your battles.
They haven't won enough to play consistent enough. They're either way too high or they're way too low.
Okay, we're talking
and it's like, man,
medium
you
pace here.
You can't play that way. It's like you make four or five really good plays, man. They think they're on top of the world. They're Superman. They're doing whatever they do, and they're way too high. Then all of a sudden, something unforeseen happens. They turn the ball over, penalty. Then they get way too low. They're way too up and down in how they play, you know. They get going really good. They feel really good. They can do anything. And then the minute something bad happens, man, they go completely the other way. And it's like that's what Northwestern does really good.
They're
not too
in the
high.
Moment.
They're not too low. They just they make their play, they go on, they do the next. They and this is what they do. So they're just super even keeled in how they play. Down, like Jay was saying, man, they're down 17-0, but they just kept doing what they're doing because that's what they do. You know, they don't panic because they have to get 17 points. No, they just do what they do, and they chip away at it. They chip away. They keep chipping away. Nebraska, they'll get it all, but they're going to get nothing. And it's like they got to learn how to just keep do what you do.
That's part of the progress of turning that corner that I think Coach Frost is talking about, right, with being able to be even keel. And Shuey, I think you're on the money with the too high or the too low. You got to just going to be gray area. And gray area is okay because that means you're not down in the dumps and you're not on a false fool's gold high.
Yeah. You got to learn to when to press the brake or press the gas a little bit too. I think good. I mean, that's just in sports in general. Sometimes, you know, you're going. You're just okay. We're hanging in there, and then all of a sudden, here's our chance. Now we go. You know, and it's like okay, we caught a couple bad bounces of the ball, a couple bad breaks. Let's hold up. Let's hold the water, and then you're like okay, now we can go again. You know, it's just Chewy hit it on the head. It's you can't get too high. You can't get that's a sense any sporting game you play, anything with a ball or stick or whatever. I mean, you've got to stay in the moment and just play. And I think he hit that on the head. Like they just get over their skis a little too fast, too quick, and they're like whoa, you know, and so they get going really fast. Like okay, we're gonna fall here in a minute, and let's try to pull the reins back. But they. Saying that gray area would be really, really good for this team.
Jay Moore is here. Mike Schuchart's here. Chris Schmidt, it's happy hour with Hail Varsity. We're at Wilderness Ridge, a beautiful Friday afternoon, 77 sunny, just perfect out on the deck. Come out and enjoy beautiful fall weather here at Wilderness Ridge. Bring your clubs. Get a tee time for this weekend for sure. Go see Shuey. And we're going to talk some more Nebraska and Northwestern. Come see us. We're here till 6. Stay for dinner. I am going to fire up a bison burger, I think. I love that.
They're
and
the
beer is cold, is all I'm going to say. Derek Peterson's going to join us. Hail Varsity continues. Roadshow Friday. Happy hour with Hail Varsity. We're out at Wilderness Ridge here till 6.
And we're back.
Fellas, I think we could listen to the radio
on Hail Varsity Radio, presented by the Nebraska Lottery.
Yes! That's awesome!
Thanks for hanging out. Hail Varsity Radio Road Show. It's happy hour with Hail Varsity. We're here at Wilderness Ridge, an amazing fall afternoon on a Friday out on the deck. Folks are enjoying wine, some cocktails, some appetizers. Sunshine and the breeze is very comfortable. Jay Moore is here. Mike Schuchart is here. Chris Schmidt, thanks for spending time. Elijah Herbel back at our Hail Varsity Studios, ESPN Lincoln. We welcome in the pride of Oklahoma, Derek Peterson, beat writer, and does a great job covering Nebraska with HailVarsity.com and magazine. Dr. Petey, yeah, Dr. Petey HV is where you follow and find him on Twitter. Doctor, good doctor, what are you doing today? Are you on the road for some playoff football?
Not for playoff football. I'm on the road to Evanston. Actually, about 15, 20 minutes ago, crossed over into Illinois. So, going to have me some Chicago pizza tonight and watch some Nebraska football in person for the first time this year tomorrow.
Man, that is a high level of jealousy emanating from me. So good on you. You are off to Evanston. That's a sweet town. My buddy Riles, not that Riles, but another Riles from Chicago, always shakes his head at those folks who go deep dish and throws some arrows, says, you tourists going with the deep dish. Deep dish. If you ask Vogel, he'll tell you to go with the hot beef, the Chicago beef, the Italian beef. But you are what pizza are you zeroed in on tonight? Where are you going?
Well, I say tonight. I'm still trying to decide if I'm. It depends on when I get there. I'm still trying to decide if I'm going to go to. There's a Illuminati's that's close to Evanston. That's going to be close to my hotel, or if I want to drive into downtown Chicago and go to Geno's. Geno's Geno's is like one of the top five restaurants I've ever eaten at. So I still have to decide if I'm leaning towards going into town tomorrow evening after all of our stuff is written and posted on LRC.com and getting me some pizza and watching the night game from there.
You know, this is just my take, but I would go into downtown Chicago. You're young, yep, vibrant. You don't need sleep. It's an early kickoff. Do it all.
Dr. Petey. We didn't get to go this year. We didn't get to go for football media days, and we're not going to get to be there. Obviously, for basketball media day, it doesn't happen. So I got to take advantage of it while I can, right?
No, I got you. What do you think about tomorrow here? What are two storylines you're circled in on with Nebraska, and what are a couple of things you have concerns about with Northwestern? Let's get into the game.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a really, really close game. I think Brandon Vogel on his podcast Thursday did a really good job of breaking down why it's going to be close. When Nebraska has the football, it's going to be good on good. Northwestern's defense is legitimately one of the better units in the country. Offensively, they're still kind of coming along and trying to figure out, you know, with a new offensive coordinator and a new quarterback, how they're going to play. They've got some new pieces and still trying to figure that out. But defensively, they've got three linebackers that are as good as any in the country. They've got, I think I ran the numbers yesterday. I think there are three linebackers, Patty Fisher, Blake Gallagher, and Chris Bergen. I think in 120-ish career games between the three of them, which is ridiculous in and of itself, they have, I think the number is 762 career tackles. These dudes have played a lot of Big Ten football. They are excellent linebackers. Fisher is an excellent inside linebacker. It's going to be interesting to see what Nebraska does with Wandale Robinson, because if it has Omar Manning, which it seems like, you know, there's the potential that they will, which would be a good sign. You know, signs pointing in the positive direction there. He's not going to come in right away and be an NFL receiver that's going to get targeted 12 times and, you know, go over 100 yards. I don't think that's what we should expect from him tomorrow. But if they have, you know, a couple packages for him, a couple plays here or there that they can dial up for him, and suddenly Nebraska has a vertical passing game, the likes of which it didn't have against Ohio State, what does that do for Wandale Robinson in terms of working kind of the underneath stuff, working the middle of the field, some of the intermediate stuff? Can they get him matched up on linebackers? Because, you know, Northwestern secondary, which has had to replace a couple guys, has to worry about a deep threat. Can they get a guy like Alante Brown onto the field more, and you know, have him be somebody that will maybe stretch the defense with his speed? They got Wandale 6 touches against Ohio State, and I think, you know, they'd tell you privately, and they told us publicly that probably wasn't enough. So I'm curious to see what they do with him offensively. And you know, the biggest X factor with Nebraska for opponents trying to prepare for this offense is what happens with Luke McCaffrey. I don't think we saw everything that they're going to roll out with Luke in week one. I think there's still a bunch of stuff that maybe they held back. But for me, the best player on the offensive side of the ball for Nebraska is still Wandale Robinson. And this offense is about getting those types of players the ball as much as possible in space for them to make plays. So I'm curious what they do with him. And then, you know, on the other side of the ball, it's can you carry over the good stuff that you had 2 weeks ago against Ohio State in the front seven? I thought Will Honus and Colin Miller played well. I thought the defensive line for stretches played really well, especially against probably the best offensive line that they're going to see all season. So, you know, if Nebraska can carry some of that stuff over defensively, you know, the game should be decided by who wins that good-on-good battle when Nebraska has the ball.
Derek Peterson's with us, Hail Varsity Radio. He is on the way to Evanston, Nebraska, Northwestern. We're here at Wilderness Ridge, an amazing fall afternoon. Come see us out here on the deck, 4 to 6, happy hour with Hail Varsity. Shuey is here, Jay Moore is here, Chris Schmidt, and Dr. Petey from Hail Varsity is checking in on the way to Evanston. So, right on the money with the Wandale Robinson needs touches. Wandale Robinson is an X factor. Defensively, you know, what is Nebraska likely to do with Ramsey? And we remember Ramsey from last year, so he knows about Nebraska. Nebraska knows about him. It's a different offense with different dudes at Northwestern, but third down's been circled, right? Nebraska didn't do their job on third down against Ohio State. That's okay, because Ohio State's going to do that to a lot of teams, but Ramsey's intriguing to me with his athleticism, and we'll get into this, Jay, with you next segment, but Derek, your thoughts, what does Nebraska do to get off the field on third down? Do they kind of play reactionary and spy a guy like Ramsey who can hurt him with his feet, or do they get aggressive and come after him?
I'm going to be boring and say Nebraska's going to win third down by what it does on first and second down.
That's fine.
Ramsey, you know, Peyton Ramsey is a guy, he just in terms of his career numbers, he's one of the most accurate quarterbacks in the Big Ten, playing in the Big Ten right now. And yes, Nebraska fans will remember him from the game with Indiana last year where he helped a Hoosier team beat Nebraska in Memorial Stadium. And I don't have the numbers right in front of me, obviously, but I think he threw maybe 30 times in that game, upwards of 30 times in that game, close to it. He threw 18 passes against Iowa. You know, this Northwestern team has run the ball 113 times in two games, and they've thrown it 48 times, I believe. So I talked to a Northwestern writer from my podcast, and she said that's kind of, you know, with the offensive coordinator coming over from Boston College, that's kind of his MO. That's kind of what they expect moving forward. Ramsey is a graduate transfer, a guy that's just really, really accurate, not going to make a ton of mistakes, fits Northwestern well. You start to toss around words like game manager. So for Nebraska, Northwestern, it seems like Northwestern is going to try to run the ball. And try to, you know, stay ahead of the chain, stay in plus situations so that those third downs are manageable for Peyton Ramsey. He doesn't have to be Superman. They've faced 35 third downs through two games, which is the most in the Big Ten so far. Going back to Brandon's podcast, I thought he hit the nail on the head when he said, you know, that's good. They've converted 51% of those so far. That's good. But that's living life on the edge. And they've played I won't say bad, up and down Maryland team that we're not sure about, and they played Iowa. So, you know, Nebraska defensively, they look good against Ohio State for stretches, right? So, you know, if you're facing 17 third downs against Nebraska, like, if you can handle your business from the cornerback's perspective, if you can handle your business on first and second down and make those third downs third and long, like, sooner or later, right, like, Nebraska's not going to be giving up pass interference penalties every time they face a third and eight. Right, like sooner or later, the switch is going to flip. They're going to have one of those games where it's not an 8-for-13 kind of game for the opposing offense on third down, just because Nebraska constantly shot itself in the foot. And there's nobody on Northwestern's wide receiver core that truly scares you in a third and long situation. So, if you handle your business on first and second, I think you got to feel good.
Derek Peterson on the way to Evanston with HailVarsity.com and magazine at Dr. Petey HV. And, of course, his podcast, The Varsity Club, with Hurrdat Media, Jay Moore, more to it. Get those locked in and subscribe. So, Derek, about 90 seconds here. Tell me why Nebraska wins. Tell me why Northwestern wins.
Northwestern will win because Nebraska either looks a little rusty after, you know, a week off that they didn't want to have, or Nebraska continues to make some of those mistakes. Northwestern's got 7 turnovers forced to the defense in the first 2 a team on your mistakes. Nebraska can't turn the ball over, can't have those kind of crippling fumbles that Adrian Martinez seems to have had problems with throughout his career. Nebraska will win if the exact opposite, if the offense is dynamic. Their offense is better, frankly. Nebraska's offense is just better than Northwestern's. It's dynamic. It's potentially explosive. It's potentially high scoring. So if Nebraska can take care of its own business, I don't know that Northwestern has the firepower on the other side of the ball to keep up with them. That's just not the way that they're built. So if Nebraska can win those one-on-one matchups on offense, this game is a toss-up game for a reason.
Derek Peterson, HailVarsity.com and magazine. And read him, follow him. He'll be reporting live from Evanston tomorrow as he's on the way to Northwestern land. Derek, safe travels. Get that pizza, brother, and tweet out a pic of that pie, okay?
I'm good. Appreciate you guys.
All right. Appreciate you. There's Dr. Petey, Derek Peterson. So he's going to be in Evanston. We're on the deck here at Wilderness Ridge. Happy hour with Hail Varsity. We're here till 6. Come on by. Just fantastic weather, mid-70s, and just pleasant. Jay Moore, Mike Schuchart, Schmidt back with more as Hail Varsity continues, presented by the Nebraska Lottery.
Chime in 402-466-ESPN or email the show, chris@hailvarsity.com.
Just try me. Try me.
Back to Hail Varsity Radio.
Thanks for hanging out. It's Hail Varsity presented by the Nebraska Lottery. Happy hour with Hail Varsity here at Wilderness Ridge. here till 6. And tell you what, man, there was some cold beer coming out from the bar area. There's wine. There's appetizers. Armand is walking by saying what's up. He's a smiling dude. What a just a great spot. And you're invited out. Mike Schuchart is here. Shuey is fantastic with Wilderness Ridge Golf. Blackshirt Husker NFLer and the More To It podcast, Jay Moore. And, of course, you see Jay on Big Red Wrap-Up. Elijah Herbal back at our studios. And can email Chris at HailVarsity.com. We are going to get into some questions. So, good stuff from Derek Peterson. He's on his way to Evanston. Bill Doleman is 20 minutes away. The infamous Clauseborne is set to go. He's a little less angry because there's going to be football this weekend, but he was not a happy guy last weekend and took it out with some of his selections. So, Jay, let's start off with this. Got a question in on the email, and with your background defensively, any explanation? And I know Coach Fisher was asked about it a little bit by our friend Mitch Sherman. You know, did Nebraska play aggressive enough? Were they able to play as aggressive as they wanted to against Ohio State specifically? Because, I mean, it's been 2 weeks since there's been football, and everyone you bump into who loves the Big Red is like, you know, Nebraska gave too much bleeping cushion to the Ohio State wide receivers. Why were the DBs off so much? Why were the safeties back so far? Of course, you got Newsom, and of course, you got Farmer, and probably some Noah Pollock-Gates and maybe some Gifford action tomorrow, at least in the first half. I think the young kids are really going to be dynamite players for Nebraska. They can tackle. They're fast. They're good in space. They know what they're doing. All that being said, you were able to sign a few footballs and then throw a pass and complete it with that cushion. What did you see from Nebraska's back end against Ohio State? Worries against Northwestern?
I mean, you won't see a similar game plan. I mean, listen, those guys that lined up at
they're going to be on Sunday.
The X and the Y and the Z and all, you know, at those positions.
Yep.
I mean, they're going to be, you know, top 2-3 rounds draft. I mean, they're going to be making millions of dollars. I mean, that's a football
millions
game.
Of dollars more.
Yeah, correct.
Wait, what are you saying?
I'm saying there's a payroll to meet.
Right. No. I like it. You know, it's we talked about picking your battles. I mean, that game, listen, football becomes, for an offensive game, it becomes a lot more difficult in the red zone because the field shrinks.
Hmm?
So that's a game where Nebraska has to, if they had a chance, it needed to be a 35-38. Listen, Ohio State doesn't get points. I mean, arguably they're the best offense in the nation. I mean, mm-hmm. And they're gonna get their stuff. You try to limit them to 3 points. I mean, you can't let them get behind you, and they still did. I mean, they still did it. You know, and like that's just gonna happen.
I thought Boodle played a great game.
Right. I mean,
he got torched once.
It's gonna happen. Like they're too good. Like it's just, you know, it's when Nebraska doesn't have a good enough pass rush. Like that's just. You might get taken over top against top offense. It's probably going to happen. You know, you'd hope they may drop it or maybe get a hand on it. But listen, they're going to get their shots. That's just a game where you just say, hey, well, we're going to play. We'll keep our cushion here. We'll keep everything in front of us. You guys, you know, once you guys get across the 30, now that field shrinks. Now mm-hmm. we can play a little tighter and then tighten up and hold you 3 points. And they did that a couple times. They just didn't. You know, Nebraska, well, honestly, that game, the offense just didn't hold up the end of the bargain. Like, people get so frustrated. Like, you know, we have 7 first-rounders in our defense, and why are we playing like this? Like, Nebraska has good football players. We don't have elite cover guys either. We don't have elite defensive linemen yet to rush the passer. Like, you got to pick your battles. Like, mm-hmm. And people are like, well, you know, they get frustrated. Like, well, that sounds like you're just trying not to lose. Well, kind of. Like you're playing the best team in the nation.
Here's the game plan. Here's why it's going to work.
The very first game of the year. Now this is not. You're not playing, you know, South Dakota State or. I mean, I can't say Cincinnati because Cincinnati's one of a really good football team. But you don't have, you know, a directional school or something to experiment and see what we have.
Your warm-up's number one in the country,
right?
Or number two in the country.
Correct. So again, you have to. You know, I'm going to keep using golf terms because, you know, we're
here in wilderness.
Yeah. Sometimes you got to lay up on a par five, you know, and just say, hope I can wedge it close and make a birdie. If not, I'll take my par and go home and move on. And that's just what they tried, and it – listen, the offense didn't hold them their deal. I mean, defense, 42 points, you know, or excuse me –
42,
yeah, because they got
the scoop and
right,
score.
The scoop and score. So
they, 45,
you know,
yeah.
45, you know, and they did their, you know, they complained a little better, but again, it's the, you're playing one of the best teams in the nation.
Shuey and Jay, I thought with third down, what do you do on third down to get off the field? Ramsey's accurate, Ramsey's mobile, and, you know, I think Feldarius Payne and JoJo can be big tomorrow. I'm anxious to see Rodgers and Robinson do their thing. I think Jordan Riley will make an appearance. And I'm not really worried about Nebraska's young kids being scared of the moment, per se, in that first half, in for Cam Taylor Britt or in for Deontay Williams. But they're going to get picked on. So when third down happens, and if it's third and five or longer, which is what you want as a defense, how do you think Chins will play it? Do you send a spy or some pressure? I know we talked with Derek about it, and he's right. Went on first and second down, jackass. I get it. But from a third down, and Nebraska gave up some third and longs. I mean, Nebraska did well at times against Ohio State on first and second down, and it was the third down scramble that killed them. And that's what screws defenses in college football, is the third down scramble. You hate those guys that are mobile.
Yeah, well, that's what happens. You bring pressure. You want to bring pressure, you're in man-to-man situations. So what happens in man-to-man situations, backs get turned because they're facing the wide receivers.
If
you lose contain, then he's off to the races. Now, I mean, let's be honest, Ramsey is not Justin Fields.
No, he's not.
I mean, I think I told you on maybe a Monday, and, you know, the most frustrating thing about the third long conversion was, you know, we had him pinned back. We almost got a safety on Justin Fields in that sack, and then they get a draw. Like, just have better situational IQ football the
okay.
team needs. But, and again, you get that from playing football and not practicing football. You got to actually do it in a game. So, listen, they're going to bring pressure. They like to bring pressure. They can get pretty exotic with that 3-4 look that they have. You're going to see a lot of different stuff, you know, coming. JoJo, they love to bring JoJo. Mm-hmm. You're going to see, you know, like to bring some A-gap blitzes with Honus or Colin Miller. You're going to see some exotic stuff just because, you know, I don't know if we can just sit back there and rush four. I mean, granted, Ohio State had a really good offensive line, but can Caleb Tanner and Garrett Nelson and Feldarius Payne, can they win one-on-one right now? Good enough to you trust them to do that? I don't know. I don't know if they're good enough you want to trust them to say, you get there, we'll sit back there with seven, and hopefully we can, you know, keep everything in front of you. But I think they're going to bring the heat.
We'll wind down this first hour. We're here at Wilderness Ridge, happy hour with Hail Varsity. Out on the deck here till 6, and get yourself a burger, get a steak. Their beef stroganoff is incredible. And the wine and appetizers, just tremendous. The heaters are out, too, so... Not that we need them, but it's going to be just
not
a
today.
Gorgeous night. You don't need them. Mike Schuchart's here, Jay Moore, Chris Schmidt. We'll wind down hour one with Hail Varsity, presented by the Nebraska Lottery.
And now, back to Hail Varsity Radio.
Thanks for hanging out. Hail Varsity, presented by the Nebraska Lottery. Roadshow Friday. It's happy hour with Hail Varsity. We're here at Wilderness Ridge. Chris Schmidt, Mike Schuchart, and Blackshirt Jay Moore. A reminder about your friends at West Blue Realty. Are you moving in 2020? You could be. And if you're looking for a residential home in Lincoln or surrounding community, West Blue Realty can help out in a big way. You mention Hail Varsity, and they can help provide up to $1,000 on the closing of your next home purchase. Tom Luby is outstanding. Give Tom a shout at 402-540-3768. Kelly Hofschneider, he's awesome. Kelly can take that phone call as well with West Blue Realty, 402-202-2312. It pays to work with West Blue, westbluerealty.com. Go see him. Get an appointment to 1120 K Street, Suite 200. Tomorrow is a big day in the Schmidt household because this thing we are growing above our upper lips could get hacked off, thankfully. with a Nebraska win. My brother has a little up top, but he's got the Magnum PI thing going. I walk in to get the show ready. Jay and Chewy both say, when's your photo shoot later, Ron? Or John, you know, when's the shoot later? I look goofy, more goofy than normal. But you're still sitting with me, and I appreciate it. I need this thing to go. I can't wait to shave. I know it's No Shave November, and that's an incredible charity and cause. But the Schmidt household, Uncle Mark, myself, we need to.
Yeah, we all need a win. Just get a Nebraska football win in 2020? I
mean, we all need a win.
2020
right?
Sucks. Can we get some good football, at least, you know, when we can play?
Nah, you're
is
not,
that too much to ask for?
You're not wrong. You're not
for
wrong.
For the sake of Pete?
Hey, it can happen tomorrow, man. We'll get our predictions. We'll get our predictions here in less than an hour. Clauseborne's going to be with us. And he'll have his picks, so will Elijah. And I'm working on a 6th consecutive steak and a beer win over Elijah.
God, I can't believe he...
6 in a row?
Yeah, well, I've got 5 in a row. I think it'll be...
I can't believe the Vikings did that to the Packers on Sunday. I
didn't even need the 9.5.
No.
Elijah's going to knock us off air. Oops, accident. Shortly. But no, I mean, yeah, it's been a crazy NFL season, to say the least. But it's good that there's football. Plenty of Big Ten to get into. I mean, I don't think Harbaugh is going to have to find his own way home tomorrow from Indiana if they lose. But it's getting heated in Ann Arbor. Iowa fans are up in arms for sure after you blow a 17-0 lead. And they want baby Ferentz gone.
Well, I was dealing with something internally right now.
Oh, just a touch.
I think is – Yeah, Nebraska, you know, let's play all Nebraska for trying to play football. But Iowa has a $20 million lawsuit going on with some former players that, mm-hmm. you know, no one really wants to talk about too much, it seems like.
Well, and it'll be interesting with Barta. It'll be interesting with Ferentz if this is their last stand, as in, hey, let's just kind of ride off into the sunset, and that's how it is. I'd be interested to see where Iowa would go for their next head coach. I don't think Stoops would get into coaching again, but a 60-year-old big game Bob wouldn't mind his time as AD, perhaps. Mm-hmm. Maybe you go that route. We will be back. Hour 2 is coming up. Happy Hour with Hail Varsity. Chris Schmidt, Mike Schuchart, Blackshirt, Jay Moore, the Pride of Fairbury, Bill Dolman's coming up. Hail Varsity continues, presented by the Nebraska Lottery.
Welcome to Hail Varsity Radio, the voice of Husker Nation. Insight, opinion, expertise, with the biggest and best names talking Nebraska across the state. Join the show on Twitter at Hail Varsity and at Schmidt_radio. Call in at 402-466-ESPN or 1-800-825-5865. Here's Chris Schmidt.
Thanks for hanging out. It's Hail Varsity Radio Roadshow Friday. Happy Hour with Hail Varsity here at Wilderness Ridge. Chris Schmidt, Jay Moore, and, of course, Mike Schuchart. Numbers to get in, 466-3776, 466-3776, 800-825-5865. Amazing weather. It's been 70s plus all week long, and what a way to end it here on the deck here at Wilderness Ridge here till 6 o'clock, but can stay beyond and enjoy phenomenal food, great menu, wine, beer, plenty of cocktails. Scotty can make you at the bar and get yourself a tea time this weekend while it's still spring and summer-like. Right, Chewy?
That's right.
It's been outstanding. Jay Moore played today and plays with people that know his skill level, so it's not always... We're not making people putt two-footers, which is good. I need to find new friends, apparently.
Let's be a better putter.
Exactly.
Ding, 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 ding. Coming up, Clauseborne. He is imaginary and wears red. The Friday forecast is coming up. We welcome in the Pride of Fairbury and NBC Sports. We say hi to Bill Doleman. Billy D., how are you?
Doing well. I'm looking forward to seeing the Huskers perhaps tomorrow when they take on Northwestern. We don't have football out here in Colorado, so nobody really has a place to watch the game. So I'm going to try and find a way to jerry-rig something up anyway.
Well, you're invited over, man. Just jump in the truckster and find your way to my folks'. We'll just throw it on the big screen there. You're welcome. You just got to take a temperature before you walk in.
As is the case everywhere. Well, I've got big red fever. I know that.
You do. How you feeling about Saturday?
Well, I feel great. I thought Nebraska played reasonably well in the opening game against Ohio State, and I was looking forward to seeing how well they would respond in game two last week, and unfortunately that just didn't happen. But you know, putting aside the score, and in fact when I look back at the Ohio State game, which I've kind of done and just reading about it and looking forward to this week, I tend to forget that was a 52-17 final score, because I really thought that we looked pretty good, actually, and I think saw so many, I thought, areas of improvement, and most notably along both lines. I thought, I thought both sides of the ball of the line of scrimmage, Nebraska played with purpose, and they looked, Big Ten ready. And not that the Big 12 was a patsy conference, and I'm certainly not going to put these guys in line with the pipeline or the great defensive lines with Junior Manares. But nevertheless, I thought, both sides of the line looked really, really good, and I think that's the most encouraging thing about moving forward.
Bill Dolman's with us, the Pride of Fairbury, NBC Sports. His thoughts on the Big Red. And, Bill, when you look at Nebraska, and we were talking about it in this first hour, it was a situation where, Nebraska being a cleaner football team, and you just kind of roll your eyes and you're sick of talking about it, but it's a reality, and that is Nebraska kind of taking care of Nebraska and playing a good four quarters of football. They did that a year ago in a really ugly kind of defensive struggle against Northwestern. But more times than not, when Nebraska's lost to Northwestern, it's been the turnover bug that's got them, and Northwestern just kind of finds a way to go blue collar and make some plays. Are you concerned at all about Nebraska being able to turn that corner? Coach Frost talks about this soon without having a second game against Wisconsin. Can they jump from what you liked against Ohio State to Evanston tomorrow with just practice time in between? It eventually has to show up on the field.
That's the most disappointing thing about having not played last week, is all the things that I thought that they looked, the areas that they looked good in that opening game against Ohio State, to see it, follow up the next week. But again, I just think anybody who has watched a lot of football and kind of knows the game, and you just see how they look. They looked sharper. They looked crisper. The tackling was better. I thought they played smarter. I thought there were so many things about what Nebraska did in that opening game against Ohio State where you go, yeah, it does look like there has been progress. And, Zach Duvall kept coming to my mind. I mean, they look like they're in better shape. And, I was thinking back as I was watching that Ohio State game. I can remember a couple of games in years past, an Illinois game, certainly last year's game at Purdue, where I thought that there was just a whole lot of give up. And, that they just didn't look ready to play. They didn't look like they, were sharp. I mean, just everything about it just didn't and wasn't there. And I just don't think we're going to see a replication of that this year. I think, that Purdue game really sticks in my mind, but there's just no effort. And there was give up. There were guys not pursuing on plays, and they weren't playing smart. And I just thought against Ohio State, it looked like that team is in better shape physically and mentally and played with more confidence maybe than we've seen in a long time. And that was going against Ohio State when a lot of teams are probably like, we don't have any confidence. It's not going to happen for us. But I thought Nebraska brought a competitive edge that we haven't seen in a while, and that's why I wish we had seen them play last week. to see that for a second consecutive week, and then going to Northwestern after, you know, a win over Wisconsin. So I'm looking forward to seeing some continuity and competitiveness and sharpness that I think was evident as a foundation for this football team.
Bill, so do you believe that in Scott Frost when he says his team is close to the corner? It's also the same coach that said, this week we had our best week of practice, but it didn't ever show in the football
He's
field.
He's not been saying recently, though.
Yeah, no, he has not. He has not, but they said he's close. Do you believe this team is close?
Yeah, I do. Just because of, Sugar, you've been around the game. You know when teams are ready. You know when guys look. You probably lined up against an opponent going, this guy's ready to play football? You know, and then you line up somebody and it's like, this guy's ready to play football, you know. And I just think it appears to me that team has put some time into the weight room. It's put some time into, you know, team building, as esoteric as that can be. It just seems like there's a crispness, a sharpness, a togetherness, a readiness that hasn't been there in the past. And that's not the fault Scott's last couple of years, but now we're seeing that, you know, the guys who have bought into the program and want to be there. So yeah, I think there's the opportunity to turn whatever corner and move forward full steam ahead. But I think there was a lot to like outside the final score against Ohio State. That's a great football team. And someday I think Nebraska will be back there, and probably sooner rather than later. And what did I you guys verified this for me. Nebraska still has like 70 or 80 players who are in their third year or less in the program. I'm talking redshirt sophomores or younger. I mean, that's amazing to me. And I've heard the comment that, you know, that Scott wants this team to get old and stay old. And, you know, I remember the days back, you know, in the 70s and 80s when teams would talk about lining up against Nebraska, and Nebraska guys had beards and mustaches and beards, and the other guys were working on their first Bic razor. And I think that as soon as we can start doing that, that's going to be a significant thing. And you've got a culture of players that are now going to grow up in this program, and I think it's very healthy going forward.
Bill Dolman's with us, the pride of Fairbury, NBC Sports, Hail Varsity Radio. Happy hour with Hail Varsity here at Wilderness Ridge on the deck. Billy D, it's what, 16 years, 17 years ago we started doing shows on the deck, man?
It's been a couple of days, that's for sure. You were working on your first deck.
Go ahead.
I said you were working on your first Bic razor.
We have been growing stashes till Nebraska wins. The Schmidt family has, mom and wife excluded, of course. And my brother and I are praying for a win tomorrow, so we quit getting, taste, quite frankly. So we look a little creepy. With Nebraska's offense, Bill, I think the offensive line's the winner tomorrow. I think they can plow away. I think Northwestern on the interior is not as deep as they need to be. They hung on for dear life against Iowa. Their linebackers are great. But I think this is a big-time kind of grow-up game for a quarterback who's played a lot of football, and Adrian Martinez, when it comes to taking care of the football. Bill, do you worry about that with Adrian? Because some guys that are really good players just are either fumblers or they just are mistake prone. As many big time plays as they make, there are some detrimental ones, and Adrian kind of owned that this week with his meeting with the media. Can he turn a corner when it comes to taking care of the football? Interceptions are going to happen from time to time, I get it, but I'm more interested about hanging on to the football because he's so good running with the football.
Okay, you know, I hear the I own it, and I've watched the press conferences, and I've heard the comments and all that, and that's great. And I'm not going to come down on him, but that kind of statement reminds me of, yeah, I got to do a better job. It's the old the guy who gets burned on a play or makes a mistake, and then they get up and they pat their chest like, yeah, it's on me. Well, no kidding, it's on you. But don't do that, okay? I mean, it just drives me nuts. Like, yeah, my bad. We know. We're watching. You blew it. you know, you shouldn't hit the guy out of bounds, or you shouldn't let the, you know, the receiver get 10 yards past you downfield. Okay, we get it. You shouldn't be fumbling the football at this stage. That's maybe job one in this game, is you got to take care of the ball. And it's, yeah. Okay, then just go do it. And I got to believe, you know, I know he got the majority of the snaps at Ohio State, but if Luke McCaffrey hadn't put the ball on the carpet once, that we might be looking at Luke starting this week. I mean, I really think in watching both of those guys play, that Luke's not that far behind. And I'd said Adrian ought to be the guy going in because of his experience. He's played against Ohio State. Luke's played against Cherry Creek and Rock Canyon, okay? But in watching those two guys, there is not a lot of difference. But whoever's going to take care of the football is going to be the guy. And Adrian can say, yeah, it's my bad. It is. So don't let it happen. And you're in your third year now, and it's been too much of a problem for too long to keep that job at this stage of his career and at this stage of the program for Scott and for that offense. That offensive line looks better. He's got some weapons. Maybe Mills has got to have more than 29 yards rushing. Oh, my God. If he's going to be the guy, he's got to be the guy he was as a freshman at Georgia Tech when he had almost 800 yards. I mean, he has got to be a more productive
back. Got to get the ball, though, man. They got to get him the ball. He only carried it nine times.
That's true. But and the other thing is, Adrian, I think this is the week where we're going to see Nebraska take some chances. There was no downfield threat at all against Ohio State. Zero. I mean, they might as well have been running patterns with Chris Garrett and Will Washington, you know? But
Garrett alone.
This is the game where you've got to stretch the field. They didn't do that at all against the great Ohio State secondary. But I think this is one where the field's got to open up.
Bill Dolman's with us, the Pride of Fairbury, NBC Sports, talking Nebraska Northwestern. Bill, what do you see from Nebraska's defense? I've got about 2 minutes here. I need your thoughts on the Husker D. And also, I need the infamous Bill Dolman score prediction before we say goodbye.
Well, Nebraska's got to play smart defensively. And I don't know if anybody caught this where Scott was talking about they've been working on tickle tackling so that nobody gets charged for targeting at all. You'll see a lot of guys
like
that are going to go for
night.
The ribs. You're going to see guys going for the bottom of the foot.
That's a new one.
I think it's going to be really cute defensive play by the Huskers so they don't get called for targeting. But I think Nebraska's defense just like the whole thing. I think Nebraska looked pretty solid defensively. Just play smart, though. I know you've been amped up for 2 weeks to play. Just go play. Don't have penalties. Don't make dumb mistakes. And I think the defense is going to be fine, especially when they get those guys back from their targeting stuff. I don't think this is a big threat like Ohio State was. But as far as what's going to happen, look, I think this is we're going to see Alante Brown at home. And we're going to give him a chance to stretch the field. And we're going to see Omar Manning. And I think what you're going to see from Omar Manning is to be the threat that Nebraska brought him in to be. In junior college, he had, 35 catches for 700-some yards receiving? Mm-hmm. 727 yards and 6 touchdowns last year. I'd look for those same numbers tomorrow. I think Omar Manning goes for 35 catches, 727 yards, 6 touchdowns. The average score in the Big Ten between these two teams is 27-24. I'd reverse those numbers. Nebraska 72, Northwestern 42.
Bill Dolman says a shootout tomorrow in Evanston, and Nebraska goes beyond half a hundred, 72-42. Take the overs, says Billy.
And a big day for Omar Manning.
I think Omar will be nice. Hopefully he's in for enough plays to make a dent or at least create some space for Wandale. Bill Dolman, the Pride of Fairbury, NBC Sports, out here on the deck at Wilderness Ridge. Happy hour with Hail Varsity. Billy D, have a great Saturday and weekend. We will get caught up with you next week as Penn State comes to town. Thanks for your input today.
And 3 weeks from today, biathlon and cross country on the networks of NBC Sports.
Bill Dolman will have that anchored and ready. Billy D, take care, buddy.
Go Big Red.
There he is. Pride of Fairbury. We'll have some thoughts here. More Nebraska Northwestern. Clauseborne, the forecast on the way.
And now,
back to Hail Varsity Radio.
We will be back. I guarantee you that. We will be back. We'll get this thing turned around. You know, I've got a track record of winning football games here, kicking ass and taking names, and we'll get back to doing that. I promise you that. As long as I'm the leader of this program, that's going to be the mindset. But for the future, for 2020 and beyond, we will be back. I guarantee you that. We will be back. I can't wait.
That's Pat Fitzgerald about kicking ass, taking names, and the program being back. Northwestern off to a 2-0 start. We're here. Happy hour with Hail Varsity. Here till 6, Jay Moore is here. And Mike Schuart's here. There's a B.J. Nannan sighting.
Yeah.
And he's three-point distance, man. I mean, he's just going to launch from three. And one of them divot dogs going to hit the putt.
He'll make it every time.
Right. We're talking about two-foot putting and how bad Schmidt is at putting. I need to get with Shuey and Little Nan, and it sounds like.
Just go get a lesson from Little Walker right there, man. He'll take care of you.
I'm going to end up handing my keys over to him.
Yeah, that's for sure. That's a given.
Yeah, we heard from Pat Fitzgerald, and you know how bad Northwestern was last year, 3-9. Their offense was horrific. The great defense, and then you fast forward, or I should say rewind 2 years ago, what happened? I mean, they had an 0-for non-conference. They blew a lead to Michigan, but they were 8-1 and won the West. And he has that program stabilized. He has an awesome grad transfer. They were hurting at quarterback. The Clemson kid didn't pan out, but he has Northwestern playing really good football, and this is driver's seat time, Jay and Chewy. Northwestern wins. It's kind of them and Purdue, because who knows what happens with Wisconsin. Illinois is Illinois, and Minnesota's 0-2. Iowa's 0-2. So this is huge for Nebraska, very big to get to 3-0 for Northwestern. Very winnable game, though, for Nebraska.
Don't you think the team knows that, too?
They do.
How important a game is. I mean, as far as...
Well, every game's important, you know. But
this one a little more so, because it's like you got Purdue and you have Northwestern that are 2-0, and you're sitting right there, and it's like you can take care of business with
these guys. The West is down this year. I mean, it's not your... Well, so far, I mean...
Football's just
crazy. It's weird. I mean, you know, Minnesota was such a good football team last year. They are not what they were last year. Iowa's not what they were last year. You know, Purdue is better than what people thought, you know, and so far through two games, and Rondell Moore has not played, you know, and...
But Bell's awesome.
Yeah.
His money.
So it's goofy. I mean, it's obviously 2020 has been a crapshoot, so crazier things have happened. But listen, I mean, Nebraska can if, you know, they play these last six games, you know, and go, you know, what's that, 5-1?
Sure.
I mean, it is
there for Nebraska,
yeah,
and I don't want to sound like I've been throwing big red Kool-Aid all day. I think, based on what I saw with Ohio State, and you get it done tomorrow, you're good on the lines of scrimmage, you're pretty deep. As long as you don't screw yourself, you should be okay to run the football. You got a good quarterback, you got a McCaffrey factor, you've got these young pups. I mean, listen, the thing that's hurt Nebraska is wide receiver play, right? The last
100%.
Two, post-Stanley Morgan, it's been wide receiver play. So what's the mindset been? All right, no block, no rock. I get it. But eventually you got to say, okay, let's work together and let's get our dudes that can be ball players on the field. And I think you're going to see that with Lubick starting tomorrow, and it's only going to grow. You're going to see Mills do his thing, and you got a 1-2 punch at quarterback run, and you got Robinson and Casey Rogers rotating in along with Stilley. You still haven't seen much of Jordan Riley. You'll see him tomorrow. Okay, he's a monster. And then you still got Snacks on the interior that gave you some good snaps. So I love Nebraska's depth, and you get Will Honus playing like he is. Some of these young pups.
You get Luke Reimers back.
Yeah. And
I like him a lot.
Spend a second on Reimers with how he can affect tomorrow.
Well, he has speed. Like,
he's fast.
He has a burst. I mean,
he's athletic.
That's just,
right?
You don't. It's just a God, God-given thing he has. It's just that burst. I mean, he can get to point A to point B really quick.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, I mean,
pretty
you
important.
Want that. Yeah, it's huge. I mean, he can maybe take a misstep and make it up. He can maybe what looks like a 5-yard gain into a no yard, you know, a tackle for a loss maybe, or, you know, right around the line of scrimmage,
good
a 1-yard gain. Yeah, and it's, I mean, the play he made at Maryland last year, I know that was, you know, I mean, that was a butt kicking, but he made it late in the game and in garbage time, but you're like, whoa, like, where you saw a pop, you saw a burst, something like, whoa, we haven't seen,
so I'm
seen
playing fast,
anyone
right?
do that in a long time in this defense. Someone just sticks their foot in the ground and go makes a play, and it's like, whoa, that looked different. You know, we haven't mm-hmm. seen that. So what he can provide, I mean, obviously, when you play as a true freshman as a walk-on, like, that doesn't happen.
No.
You're either really good or they're really thin.
Yeah.
A little bit of both.
Yeah, and they were thin. I mean, that's how – I mean, our special teams last year were so bad. But, I mean, but that just shows you the talent he can bring. And I like that he's available. And you know what? Tomorrow, if they're truly turning the corner, you got to win this football game.
Absolutely.
You got to win this football game if you're truly talking about turning the corner.
We're going to get into predictions here with Clauseborne and the Friday forecast shortly. Jay Moore, Mike Schuchart, Chris Schmidt, Wilderness Ridge is where we are at. Happy hour with Hail Varsity. We're out on the deck. It is just beautiful. Sun is going down, and it is still just very pleasant weather. Let's hear from Coach Gary Barnett. Barney was with us yesterday in the 5 o'clock hour. You know his ties to Northwestern, took the purple to Pasadena. And, you know, this is the question that has been on our mind a long time, and it's on Nebraska fans' mind because this thing is slated to go 27-24, right? So this is part one from Barnett on just why is this game so close every year, year after year? Why is it, what is it about Nebraska-Northwestern? Here's Barney.
I think having Nebraska new to the league, you know, and being a, I think Northwestern probably looks at Nebraska much like I looked at Iowa when I got there, and that is just a great deal of respect for them. Mm-hmm. You know, if you talk about great programs through the years, you know, Nebraska's in the top 10, and through the last 50 years of football, mm-hmm. I think it's really just a great deal of respect. And when you really respect somebody, you usually give them your best shot.
One last thought here from Coach Barnett on just how tight these games have been.
You're going to play a well-coached football team when you play Northwestern. Mm-hmm. They're not the most talented, but they have enough, and they're well coached, and that's what you got to do. You got to beat a well coached team, and the only way that happens is a great deal of respect and be well coached yourself.
That's Gary Barnett. So does history repeat itself tomorrow? Does this thing stay tight? Does Nebraska kind of use their advantage, their athletic advantage tomorrow? Or is that just how this chapter and verse is always going to be written between Nebraska and Northwestern? Don't completely give me a prediction tomorrow, but, you know, your gut says what about tomorrow? Is this thing back and forth, or is this thing where Nebraska can kind of get a lead, keep their lead, and breathe easy? I mean, it looked great 2 years ago, and then once emptied the liquor cabinet.
They went 99 yards and got a game-tying field goal go to overtime.
For them to go 10 points in like 4 minutes or 3.5 minutes or whatever it was statistically impossible. Like, 99.9. Like,
yeah, uh-huh.
We're talking Georgia, Nevada numbers, right? About razor thin.
Yeah, I think I fully expect Nebraska to play well. I do. Mm-hmm. I do. I think, you know, they got, you know, they showed some good things, and they can carry it over. I do think they have a chip on their shoulder. I think they feel like they're slighted. I think, you know, they heard the national media. I think, you know, they're ready to play against Wisconsin and beat Wisconsin. So I think they're have a little chip on their shoulder, and they're come out and play really good football.
That chip is huge. We've heard about the us against the world mentality. But I think you can absolutely use it between the national media, the league itself, the lack of communication from Commissioner Warren. I mean, there's a lot of motivational buttons it's a whole typewriter here, Shuey,
yeah,
for and Jay for Coach Frost this season. And he's gone at it the right way with the thankfulness. Hey, we're happy to be playing football. We want to play football. We're excited. But he's kind of gone about it too as well. We've gotten screwed a little bit. We're talking about bad hands here, and we're getting rocked
Murphy's
at blackjack,
Law.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you can dig into that. You can get your team ready. You've had enough reps in practice. Now translate it. But I'm anxious. The thing for me, too, is obviously we've spent time on third downs and how key it is for Nebraska to not get Ohio stated, right, or just get off the field. But the other side of it, too, is kind of a follow-up. Game of horse or pig or whatever. To win that, you always got to make the shot again. You got to prove it. Well, Nebraska's lines of scrimmage played so well against Ohio State. They got another opportunity to kind of go prove it again against Northwestern. That there's some talent there. But, man, between Juergens and your guard play, you can really hammer that middle of the Northwestern defense that keeps those linebackers clean. They're thin and they're two games in. They've played a lot of snaps on the interior.
Mm-hmm. This is a score prediction. I think Nebraska runs it 30-plus.
Runs the ball 30 times?
Yeah, plus. With Mills and QB run game, I think Mills will be in the 18 to 20.
He needs to be.
And you're going
to
probably have Taylor or – you know, Taylor Martinez, Adrian.
Yeah, I do that all the time, too.
Adrian and then Luke probably get some looks. 30-plus.
Fair to say 20 Q runs tomorrow?
I think it's very important. I think it's very important. I think get that QB run game going. Yeah, I mean, 30-plus, probably maybe like 40-plus.
Good with it.
Yeah, I mean, if you're getting, 65, 70 snaps, more. That was kind of a weak prediction. I mean, it might be 40 plus, keep the ball on the ground.
The play action part of this offense is what I love, right? I love how you can sting defenses. I think Austin Allen can be big. I think you're going to see. I'm not quite ready to go Bill Doleman with the 700 yards, 36 catches tomorrow for Omar Manning, but I am ready to see some gash plays, and that's how you'll convert against Northwestern. Friday forecast is coming up. Clauseborne, Elijah Herbel, Mike Schuchart, Jay Moore, Schmidt will make our predictions next. We're here, happy hour with Hail Varsity on a Friday, out on the deck, presented by the Nebraska Lottery.
He's in his 30s. But sounds like he was born with a stogie in one hand and a brew in the other.
Now, say my name.
It's Schmitty on Hail Varsity Radio.
I got the body of a taut preteen Swedish boy.
Great to have you back. It's Hail Varsity Radio presented by the Nebraska Lottery. Chris Schmidt and, of course, Mike Schuchart. Jay Moore, Blackshirt Husker NFLer. It is that time. As we are out on the deck here, happy hour with Hail Varsity, an amazing Friday night here on the deck. We welcome in Clauseborne, and it is Friday forecast time. Claus, how are you?
Well, I'm doing okay. Despite my best efforts, this segment seems, shall we say, a little more legal than it has in the past.
It is a little bit legal, Claus.
I'm sorry. I don't want to get political or anything on you. I remember, I'm old enough to remember when the Electoral College was Kansas State's opening week opponent. So I apologize for getting too ahead of myself here.
That's pretty good. Let's get the music cranked up and get into it here. How about the Friday forecast? We got a crew to get rolling. BYU and Boise tonight. -3.5 Cougars. I love the BYU quarterback. Boise in the blue turf. I'm buying BYU. Give me the Cougars 37-28, the win, the cover, as they get it done in Boise. Elijah.
I'm with you. I really like Zach Wilson, that BYU quarterback. I think he's got NFL written all over him. And a little fun story, Zach Wilson almost committed to Boise State, so maybe this is a bit of a game for him to prove something. So I like BYU big in this one. I think they're a team. Give me BYU 35, Boise State 21.
Jay Moore.
I like Boise as well. And I'll take Boise in this one, 32-24.
Okay. Shuey.
Dang. Everybody's going with BYU.
I went BYU.
I got to go with them, too. I like that quarterback. He's really good. So, I got 35-24.
Okay. Claus, what do you got, BYU or Boise?
Well, you know, Christopher, last week you said something about Penn State being unable to do the wideout against Ohio State. And even if they had a full stadium, standing room only, they would not be as wide a crowd as what would be at a BYU-Boise State game. But I agree with you. I'll take BYU in this one. I think they've got it 31 and Boise State 17.
Florida, Georgia, the COVID cocktail party, and you got the Gator offense against that Georgia defense. And in 2020, I am taking offense over defense. And give me the Gators in a close one, but a cover, 31-27. The win and cover by Mullen and that visor. Jay Moore, what do you got?
I'm going with the Gators as well. That's when I love their uniforms, love the Jordan brand. I mean, I like what Dan Mullen's doing down there. They got the offense crews, and give me the Gators as well. Oh, I wanted to say 31-24 as well. I can't do what you do, but I'll say...
I said 31-27.
31-27. I'll say 31-24 then. Okay. How about that?
So touchdown win. Yep. Should we?
Jay picking the teams like Nancy does tough based on the uniform. I like it.
No, they a few turnovers. So I'll go 28-24.
All right, 28-24.
Bulldog.
Elijah, what do you got?
Yeah, I like Georgia's lines of scrimmage too much. I'm with Mike exactly. Actually, give me Georgia 28, Florida 24.
Clauseborne, what do you have, Florida or Georgia?
Well, when looking at the Florida-Georgia line, I think it's really S-I-M-P-L-E, simple as can be. And may we all just roll our windows down and cruise through this one. Because that's how we roll. God, your mama, me, we like to get our shine on and dig down in the dirt. Really, really look tough at this one. And I agree, if you don't get that, ask Husker Nick on Monday morning. I like Florida in this one. I like the Gators 31 and the Bulldogs 21.
All right, Harbaugh may need some new khakis if they lose at Indiana. Michigan minus 3.5. I feel good about Michigan. They have been running and running laps for weeks after not respecting Michigan State. Give me Michigan 38. Give me Indiana 31. The win and cover for Michigan on the road. Elijah, what do you got?
There's two ways I could go with this. Michigan could either respond after the loss, or they could let things turn into a rock rolling downhill. Not sure where I was going with that one, but I think it goes the latter way.
I think what you wanted to say.
I think that that Indiana is a good football team. I think they get the win. Give me Indiana 31, Michigan 28.
Jay Moore.
I got to take Michigan in this one. They're a really good football team. I think they've got kind of a bad beat there against Michigan State. And I'll take Michigan by 10 in this one. Wow. I like them. I think Harbaugh gets it figured out. Give me 31-21, Michigan.
Okay. Shuey.
Yeah, I like Michigan, too. They're going to be not very happy about what happened last week, and they're going to take it out on somebody, and they're going to score a lot of points. 38-21.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Claus, what do you got here, Indiana or Michigan?
Well, you know, it's funny. I called up my good friend Lloyd Carr earlier this week, and I said, you know, since you guys up there having such a hard time counting votes for things that happened way in the past, maybe you could find a couple of AP ballots from 1997 and write that wrong. And he hung up on me and blocked my number. So I'm going to take Indiana 31 and Michigan 28.
All right, let's get to South Bend. Clemson minus 5 against the Irish. I'm not buying it. Too much Clemson, too much defense, too much ATN. Clemson wins this 31-24, the win and cover outright for Dabo and company. Elijah.
Yeah, I think Clemson got things figured out a little bit last week, how to play without Trevor Lawrence, so I like them again this week. The cover, 5 points, it's a lot of points, especially with the backup quarterback. So give me Clemson 34, Notre Dame 31. Win for Clemson, but no cover.
Jimbo, sorry. Mine's nuts. Jay Moore.
God, I like Notre Dame.
Of course
I like Notre
you do.
Dame in this one. Listen, they struggle to beat with Boston College without Trevor Lawrence. I listen, that's one of your best players now. I like Notre Dame this one. Let's go 28-24. Outright win.
The Irish. Chili.
I'm an Irish also.
All right.
I don't like the Irish, but they got a good quarterback. Book is a good quarterback.
Yeah.
Good offense.
You know. They got a good offense. I like the Irish.
Okay.
24-21.
24-21. Claus, what do you got?
Well, first of all, congratulations, Jay, on his promotion to head coach at Texas A&M by Christopher there. That was quite nice. But I had a chance to go to a Notre Dame game at South Bend for the first time last year. And people say, well, didn't you go when Nebraska played Notre Dame in 2000? I say, yes, but we turned that place into Lincoln. So I think it's about time Notre Dame wins the big game at home. And I'm going to take the Irish 31 and Clemson 21.
So I'm in the minority here. We are going to do something we usually don't do with the Friday forecast, and that is carry over the Nebraska-Northwestern prediction because we are up against it something fierce. That is correct. Is that not right, Elijah?
Yeah, we got about 20 seconds here, or 30, 30 seconds.
That's not enough time. Claus, can you hang on for a segment?
Okay.
Claus will be back for the Nebraska-Northwestern prediction with the Friday forecast. We're here at Wilderness Ridge. Jay Moore, not Jimbo, Mike Schuchart, Chris Schmidt, Hail Varsity continues from Wilderness Ridge. Nebraska-Northwestern prediction next.
Miss us?
Come here, brother. Give me a hug. Bring it in for the real thing.
We're on call for you. Catch the podcast at HailVarsity.com, the ESPN Lincoln app, or download them on iTunes.
Saddle up, partner.
Back to Hail Varsity Radio.
Well, already some hate mail from our dear friend Jim Hansen, tremendous offensive line coach at Pius the 10th. Says, you pick Clemson, you dog. He is saying Notre Dame, 37, Clemson, 22. That is Jim Hansen, our friend from Pius.
22.
Yeah, he says 15-point win by the Irish. He's talking to Kaczynski this week, Coach Kaz, and it's like the coldest beer in America is at the linebacker lounge. Mm. South Bend after a win. When you take over the stadium. Let's get back to Clauseborne and get our Friday forecast finale here. Nebraska-Northwestern. And you know what? I'm going to go first here, and I think Nebraska is ready to not only turn the corner, but they're going to peel out. And give me Nebraska a win. Give me Nebraska some flex on the lines of scrimmage. 34-21.
Ooh.
Nebraska a win.
Convincing.
A cover. And you can be sipping that beer out of joy versus out of tension.
No
tomorrow
tears.
As a Nebraska fan. Double-digit win for the Big Red in Evanston. If I'm wrong, we could all be pissed together Monday. Elijah.
Yeah, I think this is a game where Nebraska looks like the better team. But I think Northwestern hangs around. I think they get a couple short fields through turnovers. I think they stick in it, but Nebraska pulls it out in the end. Give me Nebraska 30, Northwestern 27.
30 is the number. You're right on. Jay Moore.
I gotta stick with my prediction I made on Big Red Wrap-Up and the preview pod. So I did 24-20 Nebraska, I think. I think Nebraska's plus two in the turnover category. I think Dedrick Mills gets going. 24-20.
Okay. Chewy.
And I liked what I saw at times out of Nebraska, and I think they're going to continue to do more of that. Mm-hmm. And they're going to really roll it. 42-24.
Look
Nebraska.
At Chewy.
Dang.
Bang. I like it. Claus, what do you got here, Nebraska or Northwestern?
Well, after all of the guns that we took from people like Mike Wilbon, there is not a team on our schedule that I want to beat more than Northwestern. Take that back. I'd like to beat the Iowa Grand Wizards as well. But Northwestern is really a team that's drawn my ire because he says, you know, what has Nebraska done? Well, let's take a look at what Northwestern has done, okay? Last time they won the conference was in 2000, and their consolation prize for tying in the conference was to go to the Alamo Bowl, where they lost 66-17 to Nebraska. They have been to two Rose Bowls. Nebraska's been to two Rose Bowls, and we legally couldn't play in the dadgum thing for 50 years. So what does Northwestern do for anybody besides win quiz bowls? I'll take our athletes over their mathletes any day of the week. We win big, 31 and Northwestern 7.
30, ooh, Clauseborne says 24, steel chair and the elbow. There we have it. All right, back at you Monday. We're here at Wilderness. Enjoy your weekend. Enjoy your football. Claus, you take care. Thank you.
Okay.
There he goes. That is Clauseborne. Big thanks to Jay Moore. Appreciate you, brother.
Yeah, you got it, buddy.
Shuey, appreciate you.
Ooh,
many thanks
for coming
to Wilderness
out.
Ridge for having us. Thanks to Elijah Herbal. Back tomorrow morning, weekend edition at 7 a.m. with Hail Varsity. Take care.